Hi all, welcome to my session, the step-by-step guide to exporting. Myself Neenu. So I'll be taking today what are the procedures or what are the steps you have to take care when you get into an international trade. Let's go. So before moving on to that particular procedures, let me explain what you mean by international trade. We all know, if the trade happens across the country, across the national country, it is called as the international trade, which is just opposite from the domestic trade. So in international trade, basically there are two people. One is the exporter and the second one is the importer. So the person who sells the products or who gives the service is called as the exporter. And the person who purchases these products, suppose from India, that person is called as the importer. So basically there are two people, one is the exporter and second one is the importer. So the seller of goods and services is called as the exporter, whereas the overseas based buyer who is availing the services or who is purchasing the products from India is known as the importer. So these two are the basic components in international trade. Now let's go into the detailed process. So suppose if you are an exporter, what are the steps? How do you get into this? What are the steps you have to take care when you get into the international trade? So the basic primary step is you have to register with Directorate General of Foreign Trade. That's the first basic step. It's a very fundamental step. So when you get registered and take the membership in the Directorate General of Foreign Trade, they will give you one card called as the Importer Exporter Card, IEC. I will repeat, Importer Exporter Card. It's just like the PAN number what we all have. It's a 10 digit number, and this IEC is very important for all the exporters and the importers when they get into the international trade. Unless the importers or the exporters have this IEC, they are not eligible to do the trade. If it's for a personal purpose, you are importing any kind of goods, the IEC is not necessary. But if it's for a business purpose, the IEC is very must. So you have to get the registration and the membership from the DGFT, and then you can apply for the importer exporter card. So that's the first step. Okay. Now the second step. So the first step, registration with the IEC card. Second step, you have to take the membership in export promotion councils. The export promotion councils are those authorities or the agencies in order to support the exporters in our country. They will be giving you the guidance, assistance, and they will be giving all kind of financial services, whatever you need to boost your trade or to reach your particular branch or your market into abroad. So in order to assist all the international traders, there are certain agencies set up by the government, and they are called as the export promotion councils. So the second step, you have to register with the export promotion councils in order to avail the services. If you need any kind of financial services or any kind of assistance to boost up your trade, you have to get the registration with EPC. That's the second step. So as an exporter, you have registered with DGFT, that is the Directorate General of Foreign Trade. Second one with Export Promotion Council. Now it's time to procure the orders. You have to find out an importer abroad, and so that you can send him the samples of your goods, and then you can negotiate with him. So in this process, in this particular step, you will be finding out a buyer for your product, and you will be reaching into a final deal after negotiating on the documents, your pricing, your freight charges, and so on, all those things. So once, if the importer has agreed on all these terms, and conditions, you people, both the exporter and the importer, will be coming into a deal which is called as an international trade agreement. So that's the third step. Now, so if the importer has finalized the agreement, if the negotiation has reached into a good deal, then now the exporter can start the production process. because you have to make your goods ready on the scheduled day. So in the first step, as you have got the order from the importer, you can start the production process. And so in the fourth step, you have started the production process and you have finished it. Now the batch of goods are ready for export. What do you have to do now? Your goods are going to cross the national border. So before crossing the national border, the main important thing you do not have to miss is you have to inspect the particular goods. You have to send the particular batch of goods for the quality control and the pre-shipment inspection certificate. So these people will be checking the quality of the goods you have produced and they will be giving you the quality certificate, which is very important document in this particular process. And this will be cross-verified by the customs authorities in the importer's country and the consular bodies also. So the quality control and the pre-shipment inspection, it shows how much genuine is your product, how much good is your product. They will be showing how much qualitative is your product. It shows the genuineness. So the product can be marketed very easily with the help of this quality certificate. So in the step 5, you have to obtain the quality control and the pre-shipment inspection from the particular authority body in order to cross your border. And now, so you have obtained the quality control and inspection certificate, and now you can dispatch the goods. The very simple step, you have obtained the insurance certificate. Now you can dispatch the particular goods to the port. It can be to the marine port or to the airport for the shipment. And the next one, very important thing, the 7th step is insurance. Avail the insurance. Avail the insurance certificate from the country, because it's a very risky business you are going to deal with. You may have to face different kinds of risk in between the shipment. So in order to secure your safe custody, the goods safe custody, and in order to make you risk free, you have to obtain the insurance certificate from the company for the particular goods or services what you are going to provide. You have to just make safe free, risk free, make your business risk free. In order to make that risk free, you have to obtain the insurance certificate from the certain company. And the next one is the, from here onwards, it starts the documentation process. So if you have completed all these processes in order, that is obtaining the registration certificate with DGFT, APC, finding out an importer, sending the goods for the inspection, and getting an insurance certificate for your goods. Now all the basic, the first phase is over. Now we are moving on to the second phase. The step 8, again, it's asking for the shipping bill. So your goods have been reached into the port, the marine port or the airport for the shipment. Now, sometimes you may not be having enough space to warehouse or to store all these goods. So you will be finding a C&F agent to store all these goods till the time it's been shipped. And C&F agent or the clearing and forwarding agent will be storing all your goods in his warehouse till the date comes, and he will be charging certain charges, and that charges which it will be documented into a particular format which is called as the shipping bill. So the shipping bill contains what? The name of the goods, the date you are going to make the shipment, the port from where you are going to ship, the dispatch or the arrival port, all those things. So all the details with regard to the quantity of the goods, the name of the product, and all the other things will be mentioned in the shipping bill. And the C&F agent will be calculating some charges for the warehouse charges, and this is the pro forma of that shipping bill. So he will be calculating a particular amount will be given to the exporter, and the exporter is supposed to pay back this particular amount to the C&F agent. And this document is very important, because if this document is only produced in front of customs authority, the goods will be approved for the shipment. So the shipping bill is very important for the customs department to give you the approval to make the shipment of the goods. And the next one is the made receipt. So the customs authority has given you the approval to ship your goods. Now the captain of the ship will be giving the made receipt. This document is very important, showing the proof. It's a proof saying that the captain of the ship is giving an undertaking saying that this much goods has been placed onto the vessel on this particular day, on the name of the vessel where the goods has been placed, the date where the vessel is supposed to start, and where the particular goods is to be placed or which is to be dispatched, the port of discharge, and the other charges. So all the things, it's just an undertaking that these goods has been taken into the vessel in this particular condition, in this particular status, and will be discharged onto this particular port on this scheduled date. So that's an undertaking, and that undertaking is called as a mate's receipt, which is issued by the captain of the ship to the superintendent of the port. Got it? And the next one is the bill of lading. So the superintendent of the port will be adding his own port charges and will be making the, and that payment has to be made by the exporter. And finally, the shipping agent, whoever the agent of the shipping company, they will be providing the bill of lading to the exporter or to the C&F agent. So they will be calculating some extra charges, the bill of lading charges, onto this particular document, and this will be given either to the exporter or to the C&F agent. So the exporter has to collect all these three previous documents like the shipping bill, the mate's receipt, and the bill of lading. So all these goods are very important when you do a export business or when you set up a business with the importer. You have to collect all these documents as an exporter. And the next one, it is a certificate of origin. So all these, the previous three documents are connected with the shipment, and now it comes to the certificate of origin. The certificate of origin is very important. It shows where the goods have been manufactured. If the goods are manufactured in India, the Indian embassy or the Indian particular body has to provide the certificate of origin. It just shows the goods which has been reached in the importer country. It just shows where the goods have been manufactured. So by showing this particular document, the certificate of origin shows the real origin of this particular goods. And this is a very important thing. So as of now, the exporter has collected a number of documents. Like there were some other documents like invoices, other insurance certificate, inspection, we have called the quality control certificate, shipping bill, mates received, bill of lading, certificate of origin. So here it's the process now reaching into the final phase. You can see the exporter here. So the exporter is collecting all the goods. He is dispatching all the goods to the importer. In between this exporter and the importer, two people are there. Two intermediaries are again there. One is the exporter's bank and the next one, it is the importer's bank. Why? Because is that, first of all, the transactions are made in foreign currency. So in order to make the business risk-free and more comfort and convenient, there will be two banks named, the exporter's bank and the importer's bank. Whereas the exporter's bank will be residing in the exporter's country, importer's bank will be residing in the importer's country. So, in spite of all these documents getting transferred, the goods getting transferred, the exporter will be collecting all the previous said documents and it will be given to the exporter's bank. See, the exporter is handing over all the documents to the exporter's bank. So, the exporter's bank will be cross-checking all the documents has been fully filled and furnished, and once the verification is over, the exporter's bank will be sending all these documents to the importer's bank. who is residing in the importer's country. So the importer's bank is the one who is advising the importer how much documents to be collected, what will be the freight charges and all the other things. So all the necessary advices and the guidances are given by the importer's bank in this particular case. So once all the documents has been handed over to the importer's bank, the importer's bank will be going through and or they will be cross verifying each and every document, whether it has been fully filled, it has been met the terms and conditions as set in the particular agreement. If it's okay, if it's fine as they said in the agreement, all these documents will be handed over to the importer. And while presenting the documents, again, the payment terms we have been talked till now. Two kinds of payment terms are there. The one is the documents against payment and the next one it is documents against acceptance. So when the importer's bank, the draft, there will be a draft in between this particular document. Among all these documents, there will be one document called as the billing document or one draft will be there. It can be the bill of lading. It can be the side draft or the usance draft. If the importer's bank is giving the side draft to the importer's bank, in order to collect all the documents from the particular bank, importer's bank, then he is supposed to give away the payment at the same point of time. And that is called as the side draft. If the importer's bank is presenting him the side draft, the importer or the buyer of the goods is supposed to make the whole payment to the bank at the same point of time. If he is unable to make the payment, he will not be able. He is not supposed to collect the documents which has been sent from the exporter to the importer's bank. They won't be giving it if it is a side draft. Second case is the usance draft. If the exporter is giving the usance draft to the importer's bank, then the importer is getting a time period to give the payment. So, in that period of time, he can collect all the documents sent by the exporter to the importer and the importer will be giving away all the documents on the condition that after 30 days or 60 days, he will be remitting the whole payment. And this condition or this facilitates if this draft provided is usance draft. It is giving away the importer the license to give the cash after a certain period of time. So by the time he can collect all the documents from the importer's bank and can remit it in the importer's pot. So, after the collection of all the documents from the importer's bank, he can give away the documents which has been collected from this particular bank to the importers in the port of importer's country. And so that if all these goods has been produced in front of them, they will be discharging all the goods which has been shipped from the exporter's country. So, this is the process of internal or the exporting trade. How do you export the trade? The last pic shows the diagram how the goods or the documents travels from one place to another place, the whole process. So it just shows how the international trade or the export happens here. Basically, there is exporter and the importer. The exporter dispatches all the goods as required by the importer. The goods are being shipped to the importer. Once the goods are shipped, in between this point of time, they will be collecting so much documents. I mean, the exporter will be collecting loads of documents from different authorities. And these collected authorities are sent to the exporter's bank. So, the exporter's bank will be checking all the documents are purely filled and they will be cross-verifying and will be sent to the importer's bank in order to make the payment risk-free. Because it's the trade between two countries. So you have to ensure all the documents are being there and then only the payment can be made. So once again, I'm telling if the exporter is giving away the side draft, the importer is to make the payment at the same at that point of time whenever the documents are presented. If he's not able to make the payment, then the documents will not be handed over to the importer. Suppose if it's a usance draft, the exporter is again giving a credit period of time. So that he will be granted again a 30 days credit period or 60 days credit period for the importer to give the cash to the importer's bank. And by the time he can collect all the documents from the importer's bank and he can furnish all those documents in the port office of the importer's country so that he can collect all the goods from the port and then can float the goods into the market. So this is the process of the exporting, the steps to steps to the international trade or the exporters, whatever things they have to maintain when they get into the international trade. So this is all about the presentation. If you have any doubts, you can contact me on the particular mail ID ninujose@alberts.edu.in. Thank you all.